So welcome everyone to this very exciting event. We haven't been online for a while now, but we're very delighted to be welcoming an old friend to speak with us this evening. For those of you that haven't been to one of our events before, I know we've welcomed a lot of members of the public tonight, which I'm really pleased to see. We are RCA Drawing. We started as a drawing collaborative venture, me and Lucy Galway, 3 years ago now, running drawing classes for staff and students at the RCA. We went online in the pandemic and we've had tremendous success with bringing drawing to students at a distance. And we're diverging slightly. Usually we run practical classes, but we love this, our speaker so much. And we I've seen his talk before and we really wanted to bring it to a new audience. So without further ado, I will allow Lucy to introduce you to Dominic.
Yes, hello everybody. Hi again to everyone I haven't seen for a while across the Zoom screen. Sarah said some lovely things there about RCA Drawing and its origins. And I just like to say that I'm very happy to welcome Dominic, who is a friend and former colleague from the V&A. To the screen this evening, and we have the honour of listening to his latest version of his ongoing lecture series, Our Life Models Artists. I know even before hearing Dominic's lecture that it is sure to bring with it challenging, insightful and inspirational questions about the position of life modelling within contemporary art practice today. And from a personal perspective, I knew immediately when I started working with Sarah on our classes that Dominic was the model I wanted to work with when we started developing ideas for our classes after work. I remember fondly our classes in the senior common room with Dominic when we were surrounded by an incredible collection of paintings and sculptures and our many wonderful students who would come very enthusiastic and ready to draw. And from a personal perspective, Dominic did so much to help me explore and experiment with ideas relating to teaching and drawing. So I very much in the early days of his work got a model who was not only willing to take part, but he was incredibly enthusiastic about taking part in mine and Sarah's teaching experiments. And he offered a kind of live, critical, historical reflection on what we are doing then and there, which I found quite unique. In the past, my experience of working at art college, of being at art college and going to life drawing classes, the model would often take a secondary position, and it was very much the tutor in the room who is coming up with ideas and reflecting on what we are doing. But Dominic was very engaged from the start in the kind of pedagogy that Sarah and I wanted to explore. And particularly this relationship between the drawn mark and himself, and this symbiosis he saw between what the students were making and what he was doing with a particular pose in the room at that time. So I know since that time we've had a little bit of a break from working with him because of the pandemic and the restrictions that have been in place from having a life model in the college and being in the college at all. But I know that he's taken great strides in his visual practice and his writing and his work on theory as well. So without further delay, please join me in welcoming Dominic to this evening's event. Go ahead, Dom.
Oh, wow, I'm overwhelmed. Thanks so much for that wonderful introduction, Lucy. And as you'll discover, we're about to stream a pre-recorded lecture and then there'll be a Q&A session after it concludes. I have a very close relationship with Sarah and Lucy. And in fact, with Lucy, I was just thinking how it must be about 10, I've known you for about a decade, I think it must be now, Lucy.
Yeah,
it's quite a while.
We worked together at the V&A and we were always discussing things. And then, as I say, I remembered you when we came up with the idea of our classes and
So I've been involved with RCA Drawing since its inception. And The RCA means a lot to me, and the possibility to deliver this lecture through this platform is tremendously important, because it's such a prestigious platform, in fact, that I think it validates a lot of what I have to say, what I'm about to talk about. Also, hi, Shauna, I just noticed you there. Hey, it's really nice to see you. Nice to see all of you. And so I suppose my work's concerned with this emerging art historical debate. And my particular focus, because it's quite a wide debate, but my particular focus is on the possibility that life modelling might become an artistic practice in its own right, and that there are two determining factors that would make that so, because I don't say that this is the case in an absolute sense, but I suggest that according to motivation and context, so that's the motivation on the part of the model for engaging in their practice, and then the contexts within which they locate their practice, it might become an artistic practice. But of course, models fulfill a myriad of different roles, and I think it's important to assess these different roles, to analyze them. And so I hope that I do that in this lecture. I hope I'm able to go some way towards doing that. I don't have an absolute position, but I do think it's very important, or let's say it's unfortunate, that many of the attitudes that people hold currently, which are changing, but prevailing attitudes suggest that models are what I refer to as mercenary drawing instruments. This is something I reject. It really frustrates me, but I think that there are reasons, which I'll explain in a moment, why this is the case. And I think ultimately it's that the filter by which the life model is interpreted and understood is the Western academic tradition of fine art, painting, sculpture, drawing, within which the model assumes, you could suggest, a passive role as a mercenary drawing instrument. And I think that that's the filter by which models are understood, and historically, but all the way to the present day. We're inextricably linked together with the academy schools which emerged in Rome, Florence, Paris, and London. I still work at the Royal Academy, and I love the RA with all my heart. But I think the attitude of the life model is often understood through that filter of perhaps academic drawing. And I find that quite a narrow field. Anyway, it will make more sense when you view my lecture. I'm ever so slightly nervous right now, so I wasn't when I recorded it. But I hope you like it.
That's wonderful, Dom. We can't wait to hear it. And just to let everybody know that after the lecture, which I think, how long is the recorded lecture,
it's,
Dom?
It's weirdly, it's 47 minutes and 47 seconds, but that wasn't intentional. But also the other thing is that, just so that you know, because I watched it back the other day, and there is admittedly, the preamble is a bit too long, so you might find that I don't properly get to the subject. It might take a little while before I get there, but probably about 7 minutes.
Wonderful. It sounds wonderful. Would you like us to get, maybe this moment, is everybody ready? Do they have a cup of tea? Do they have popcorn and everything they want? Should we popcorn. Give you like 30 seconds? I'm just going to get a glass of water. After the lecture, we're going to have a Q&A with Dom as well. So a great opportunity while you're watching the lecture to perhaps make a few notes or think about questions you want to ask Dom if you need anything clarifying after. So yeah, well, Sarah's ready, I think, but I'm just going to grab a glass of water, and well, we look forward to hearing the lecture in a sec.
Do you want me to stream it, Dom, or are you going to do it?
You can if you want to.
it's not if I want to, it's what's easiest for you.
Could you stream it, please, Sarah?
For those that are asking, the recording, I will try and make it available to members of the public. At the moment, our recordings generally are only available to RCA staff and students, but I'm going to see if I can subvert the usual way that we upload them so that they are available after the fact, and I'll put on our social media so you can access it. Okay, right. Give me 1 second. If everyone could give me a thumbs up if they can see this. All good? Okay.
Hello and welcome to this RCA Drawing online lecture, within which we will journey together over the next 45 minutes or so into the existential realms within which the life model exists, travelling from art history into art practice. RCA Drawing is an ever-growing community which I've been involved with since its inception, and it aims in part to promote philosophic inquiry through the engagement in the physical practice of drawing and other outlets of artistic expression. Before I begin my lecture, I would like to take a brief moment to thank Lucy Galway and Sarah Mercer, who co-founded RCA Drawing and the research portal through which I'm talking to you. Lucy and Sarah have worked tirelessly over a number of years to curate engaging events based at the Royal College of Art that have brought people together, providing a platform for the exchange of ideas and creativity. Importantly, for the purposes of this lecture, RCA Drawing promotes the artistic potential of the life model, never assuming that life modelling is what I term a form of anatomical data entry, rather that it's a form of symbiotic performance art. For that reason, I'm very pleased to be here with you this evening. And this is the fifth lecture that I've delivered in response to the question that I've been posing, are life models artists? In 2019, I lectured on this theme at venues including the National Gallery, Marl Galleries, and Hampstead School of Art. And I'll lecture later this year at the University of Kent and Middlesex University. In 2020 and in 2021, I updated my lecture to reflect the changing ways in which the pandemic impacted the life drawing universe, both existentially and experientially. Of course, we're now moving into the post-pandemic landscape, and it's clear that the seismic changes emerging out of this period have permanently altered the calculus upon which our understanding of the life model is based. We will discuss those changes later. And so over the next 45 minutes or so, we will consider themes including the changing role of the life model throughout art history and misunderstandings of it, the possibility that life modeling might itself be an artistic practice within the realm of performance art, the attitudes of art schools towards life models and how they shape wider cultural perceptions, distinctions between the muse or sitter and the life model, especially within the context of the art school, because although directly connected, when located within spectrums of creativity, the life model and muse may be understood to exist at opposite ends. Although connected superficially, the role of the muse and model could be considered distinct from one another. We will also consider issues of objectification and the way in which differing contexts alter perceptions, with particular reference to gallery and museum spaces and those beyond. These are all issues that I have been writing, talking, living and breathing, and in some specific ways that I'll discuss, campaigning about since 2016. Although I will be advancing several theoretical assertions, all of which I developed during this period, and some of which are underpinned by art historical foundations, I am not an academic, rather an artist and a writer responding to deeply personal experiences that I felt compelled to write about. In preparation for this talk, I interviewed a number of significant art world figures, including the directors of several major museums, galleries and private collections, life models, fine art students and curators, to gain their insight into whether they felt that life modelling might be an artistic practice in its own right. Included within the group of interviewees who I owe a debt of gratitude to are Christopher Lebrun, the past president of the Royal Academy, Lara Wardle, the director-curator of the Gerwood Collection, Joe Baring, the director of the Ingram Collection, Simon Martin, the director of Pallant House Gallery, Jill Saunders, senior curator in the V&A's Department of Word and Image, Anne Noble Partridge, director of London Drawing, and figurative artists J.J. Delvine, Suzanne Lagarde, Desmond Healy and John Close. I also interviewed life model Robin George, and I'm very grateful to Professor Jean Wainwright for her support. Should also point out that Suzanne Lagarde, figurative artist, is in fact also a life model. And you might be interested to know that this lecture has received press coverage at the national level. In 2019, The Guardian ran a feature about my work. And here is a quote from the article that Tim Johns, associate editor of Guardian Culture, penned. It meant a lot that he wrote those words, although I'm not so keen on the term pose, as I'll explain later. And BBC Radio 4 also interviewed me at the National Gallery for a podcast about my work, which is available to listen to both via my website, dominicblake.co.uk, and Radio 4's website. And by the way, links to this lecture will be available at the end for your reference, both within the lecture itself and also on the RCA Drawing website. And Maeve Doyle, Artistic Director of the Maddox Gallery, interviewed me on her Soho radio programme, A Private View. For those of you unfamiliar with my work, I'm an art writer and a videographic performance artist. I'm co-curator with my colleagues Dr. Aurélie, Debaene and C.A. York of Revaluing the Life Model in Art Practice, a symposium at the University of Kent's Aesthetics Research Centre, which will take place later this year. Aurélie attended my first lecture in this series at the Mull Galleries in 2019, and many of the themes that we will explore within the symposium emerged out of it. I'm a contributing writer for Aesthetica magazine and the Charleston Press, and in the summer of 2023, this lecture series will be published in book form by a major publishing house I'll let you know about in the coming months. Between 2015 and the start of 2019, I worked full-time as a professional life model for almost every art school, museum, gallery, and life drawing group in London. Although I still life model at the Royal Academy, I moved away from modelling in art schools for reasons that I'll explain later on. And that was to develop my career as an art writer and a performance artist, but it was for more complex reasons than that might suggest. My work sits at the core of an emerging art historical debate concerning the role of the life model. And I believe that the arguments I will present within this lecture are validated by the support of the important art world figures I have just mentioned, and further legitimised by my having been invited to talk within arts and academic institutions, including the National Gallery and the Royal College of Art. These core stakeholders and the art press have all expressed sympathy with the new way of understanding the life model that I advocate. Further, I believe that we find ourselves at the start of 2022 in a profoundly important moment within the emerging debate, and that the critical ways in which the life drawing universe has changed since I first began working as a life model and campaigning to alter perceptions are almost entirely positive. While not claiming in an absolute sense that life modeling is an artistic practice, I advocate a more enlightened position according to which it might become one, given particular motivations on the part of the practitioner and the contexts within which they locate themselves. As we will discover, motivation and context are the critical factors that I believe allow us to draw conclusions in response to the question at the core of this lecture. And I was motivated to write this lecture in 2016 as a result of my increasing conviction that the role of the life model is often misunderstood, and that this misunderstanding is grounded in cultural paradigms that suggest models are servants, or what I term mercenary drawing instruments, rather than having the potential for being autonomous creative beings with agency, artists in their own right. These cultural paradigms may be explained via reference to art history, and we will discuss them today. But what does it actually mean to describe yourself as a life model? Well, life modeling isn't actually the easiest practice to define, both because life models fulfill a myriad of different roles, and also because there are probably as many different motivations for life modeling as there are life models out there. And if, as I mentioned, life models might be considered to be artists, their artistry is likely to be intrinsically linked to their motivation for life modeling. And this is a term that we will keep returning to, motivation. Although, as I just mentioned, definitions are complex, I think it is important to attempt to define our terms before going further. According to MoMA, the Museum of Modern Art in New York, a life model is a person who poses for an artist. A life model is a person who poses for an artist. And Wikipedia suggests that a life model poses for any visual artist as part of their creative process, providing a visual reference for the human figure in a work of art. Life models are also used within drawing, painting, and sculpture classes as instruments from which students may learn to draw the human figure. They go on to say, however, that more than simply being the subject of art, models are often thought of as muses, a source of inspiration without whom the art would not exist. Although those definitions are legitimate, accurately describing some of the roles the life model fulfills, I have serious problems with them. We will return to those definitions in a moment, but I think it's also important to consider how the term artist may be defined. The Collins English Dictionary suggests that an artist is a person skilled in one of the fine arts, someone who draws, paints, or sculpts as a profession or hobby. And the Cambridge Dictionary suggests that an artist is someone who paints, draws, or makes sculptures. It's my contention that those definitions, which I believe to be widely accepted, are far too narrow in their scope. Unlike dancers, who most people accept without hesitation to be artists, life models are often only viewed as muses, or what I term mercenary drawing instruments. Returning to our previous definition, this means to say that life models are not often considered to be creative artists in their own right through their practice, merely the catalyst or conduit for the artist, someone who draws, paints, or sculpts, to create their work. The muse merely fulfills the artist's vision. It might even be considered, therefore, that the life model is located within a hierarchical power structure, within which the artist or student is located up here, and the model is down here. This is where the artistry is taking place, not down here. Or at least, if it is, it's only considered to be to a minimum extent. And it makes sense that these should be the prevailing attitudes, because traditional academic definitions of fine art have become the filter through which the life model is interpreted and understood. The role of the life model may be considered to be inextricably linked with the emergence of the academies in Florence and Rome in the 16th century, and later in Paris and London. And here you can see the École des Beaux-Arts in Paris, and here is the Accademia di San Luca. Please forgive my accent. Within the context of the academy, especially during the periods in which they emerged, the model served a mercenary function as a drawing instrument, a tool for the students who assembled to draw them within life drawing classes to learn from. And I've worked within many anatomy classes, for instance, within which a tutor prescribes poses, allowing the students to discern and learn the anatomical and musculature structures. This knowledge provides a critical grounding in understanding the complexities of the human form, ultimately informing the emerging artist in their drawing or sculptural practice. In every sense, the model becomes an object, a series of curves and lines that light and shade fall across. And this notion of objectification should not be viewed negatively in this context, only viewed dispassionately, because within the anatomy class, the role of the life model is very specific. It's unlikely to be the context within which modelling becomes an artistic practice, nor would it be appropriate for it to be. The photograph on the screen at the moment was taken within an anatomy class that I worked within at the Royal Academy in 2017. Gerald Libby, the former professor of anatomy at the Royal Academy, was teaching his students about the ways in which the skeletal structure operates. I had no objection to being objectified in that context. Importantly, I was not engaged in an artistic practice through my work as a life model within Professor Libby's classes. I was a mercenary drawing instrument. I'd like you to keep hold of this idea of the anatomy class
and the role of the and the role of the life model within it, as we now move on to discuss the role of the muse. And I'd like to remind you about the previous definition that we considered, that the muse is a source of inspiration for the artist. The muse is a source of inspiration for the artist. So let's pause for a moment and look at some famous muses who you'll probably be familiar with. Here is Lizzie Siddal, the Pre-Raphaelite muse, the Pre-Raphaelite model, who famously modeled for John Everett Millais in a bathtub for his painting Ophelia. Siddal modeled over a period of months, eventually catching pneumonia. It wasn't very pleasant for her. Not a very pleasant experience at all, in fact. And here is Lizzie Siddal again in one of Rossetti's most arresting drawings. And two of my favourite Giacometti drawings of his brother Diego. And here are a couple of wonderful paintings by Ewan Uglow. The model was Cherie Blair, the eminent human rights lawyer, who sat for Uglow while she was still a student. And Botticelli's Birth of Venus. Although there is some debate, it's believed that Simonetta Vespucci was Botticelli's model. And finally, the inspirational Sue Tilly, who was Freud's muse for his painting Benefits Supervisor Sleeping. It's significant that all of the muses we just viewed are famous mainly by association with the artists who painted them, rather than for other reasons. I don't actually have any antagonism at all towards the artist-muse relationship. As we just saw, the portraits artists paint of their muses may be deeply moving, powerful, and beautiful. Having sat for many portraits, the experience can be a very moving experience indeed. And in fact, I've selected a few portraits of myself that I hope demonstrate this. This is a portrait that Sam Dalby, who's a member of the Royal Society of Portrait Painters, painted of me in his studio in Settle, North Yorkshire. And I think that portrait painters often extract the souls of their subjects onto their canvas. This was clearly the case on the day that I sat for Sam, as you might be able to tell. Because during this period, I was suffering from, unfortunately, I was suffering from a period of intense depression. And in fact, on the morning when this painting unfolded, I was unsure whether I'd be able to sit for Sam. But I realized, and so too did Sam, that it would be the ideal time to do so because it allowed me to be open with my emotions rather than to hide from them. And I think Sam's painting is a very beautiful document of that moment in my life. I'm very pleased that it happened. And here's a painting by Jane Clatworthy. I think that it demonstrates a vulnerable aspect of my personality. And Jane is almost exclusively known for painting male nudes and is very interested in the notion of the female gaze in art history, as opposed to the male gaze, often represented in paintings that you might find at the National Gallery, for instance, of female nudes reclining. And here is a rather more confident version of myself. This is a portrait that David Caldwell, the Scottish painter, painted of me in his studio. And David, of course, is also a member of the Royal Society of Portrait Painters. And this is a pen and ink drawing of me that Dan Whiteson drew. And as you might be able to tell, Dan Whiteson is very intrigued in and very interested in and intrigued by vorticism and cubism. And I think that this comes across powerfully in his work. And finally, a portrait that London-based artist and tutor Desmond Healy drew of me within his class at Hampstead School of Art. And I think that this is also a very powerful drawing, which I'll be returning to a bit later on. So you see, it's not that I have any antagonism towards the artist-muse relationship. Clearly, it can be a very powerful dynamic to inhabit, an essential aspect of the human condition, I would propose. My issue is that the life model is often directly associated with the muse or sitter, and that this association results in the roles being considered interchangeable or even identical, rather than being distinct from one another, or at least, as I suggested earlier, at opposite ends of the spectrum of creativity. While sitting for the portraits that you just viewed, I was not personally engaged in any kind of artistic practice. Within those paintings, or at least within some of those paintings, the forms that I created were prescribed to me by the artist painting me. And in others, I was simply asked to sit in a relaxed position that wasn't contrived, rather naturalistic. I was in every way a muse, and my role was to serve the artist's painting me by providing inspiration through my emotional engagement, not through my artistry, but through my emotional engagement. And I'll come back to that in just a moment. Within the context of the art school, portrait modelling or sitting, which is often clothed, might be considered to be akin to life modelling, which is often nude, mainly nude, within the anatomy class, insofar as there's limited scope for it to become an artistic practice. A portrait model is often directed by a tutor to construct a prescribed seated pose for their students to realise on their canvas, or perhaps in clay. They might sit for as long as an hour without moving, their eyes fixed on a focal point somewhere in the distance on the studio wall, perhaps, or on the floor. And here is a photograph of me sitting for portrait class at the Royal Academy, which Andrew James taught. While the muse or portrait model might be charged with an emotional intensity, which is only natural given that they're human rather than a cast, and you know that they're an individual with all the various idiosyncratic character traits that together make up their personality, that emotional intensity should not be confused with the notion of artistry. The muse will inevitably be experiencing sets of emotions that the artist might hope to capture. However, unless like Gilbert and George, you assume that all human activity might be considered to be charged with artistic intent, even making a cup of tea, it's my belief that the scope for the portrait model to be engaged in an artistic practice through their work in the context of the art class or beyond in the artist's studio is limited. The portrait model and the anatomy model assume passive roles. But might there be contexts within which the life model could be considered to become an artist in their own right? Emphatically yes. Emphatically yes is the answer to that question, I believe. While life models might be muses or sitters, their role is infinitely more complex than that would suggest. Whereas the muse serves the artists who they sit for, posing for them, the life model may be considered to have a greater artistic potential in their own right, as I will now explain. In contexts within which the life model is afforded the opportunity to improvise and inhabit the forms that they create, life modelling might become an artistic practice. This likely occurs within the art class during short pose sessions within which the life model improvises forms that last for a matter of seconds to perhaps 5 or 10 minutes. The life model then uses their body consciously as their medium of expression to create ephemeral works of art in direct response to the environments they have located themselves in, the people they share them with, and to their bodies themselves. These works of art may exist only as long as the model, the artist, is able to maintain them physically. In this way, in the context of the life room, the life model might be considered to become a performance artist. This would undoubtedly be the case, and it would be reliant, in fact, on the model's motivation for creating their forms being born out of a specific desire to realize a personal artistic vision, whether entirely spontaneous or choreographed. A moment ago, I showed you a portrait that Desmond Healy drew of me within his life drawing class at Hampstead School of Art. That portrait unfolded over a period of around 10 minutes. Immediately after which, I asked Desmond whether or not he felt that life models were artists. And he instantly replied, yes, yes, Dominic, of course they are. They draw in space with their bodies. And you see, that's precisely how I define my own practice as a life model. I came to life modeling with a very specific goal in my mind, to be creative, to use my body as my medium of expression to create works of art. I'd worked for a number of years prior to becoming a life model in a series of glorified data entry jobs in the museum sector, the V&A, British Museum and Royal Museums Greenwich. And at some point, after years of writing reports about issues that I wasn't really very interested in, my mind began to melt. I'd leave my office for lunch, having almost forgotten where I was, and find myself wandering into the Parthenon galleries. And even though I was located in such close proximity to some of the most beautiful sculptures on Earth, and here is, of course, Ilissos, the river god, my favourite Parthenon sculpture, I felt so near, yet so far from them. So when I became a life model, it was of ultimate importance to me that it wasn't another glorified data entry job. I didn't want life modeling to become what I've termed a form of anatomical data entry. I didn't want to be a muse with limited or no creative agency. My work dictated to me by someone else. I wanted to engage in an artistic practice, to become an artist in my own right. So from the start of my career, I defined life modeling as a physical mode of artistic expression within which my body was my medium. Through talking with Desmond Healy, I expanded my definition, and I now define life modeling as a physical mode of artistic expression within which the model uses their body as their medium to draw in space. And that's within the symbiotic creative relationships that they share with the other artists, and beyond those relationships within other contexts. I admit that that's quite a verbose and possibly clumsy syntactical construction. However, in defining life modeling in that way, I assert the creative potential of life modeling as an artistic practice, and I redress the hierarchical power structure that I mentioned earlier. Whereas before the relationship was artist-model, the relationship now becomes artist-artist, and we exist on a plateau in creative symbiosis. I actually go further than that, in fact. Within the scheme of my own practice, I feel that there is no distinction between what I'm doing and what the other artists who draw, paint, and sculpt me are. A painter might use oil paint as their medium of expression to draw onto their canvas, for instance. I'm using my body as my medium of expression to draw in space. And we travel on collaborative artistic journeys together that are electric to me. Two distinct artistic practices coming together in symbiosis to create a new work of art. I sometimes find that words only go so far towards explaining my practice, and through actually viewing it, its artistic value might immediately be understood in an unambiguous way. So I'd like to show you a few slides of some of the work that I've created in the life room and studio context. The inspiration for the ephemeral forms that I create emerges spontaneously in solitude and also in collaboration with the other artists I work with. Although I'm interested in figurative art in all its various forms, I'm intrigued by the possibility of moving from the figurative into the abstract, contorting my body in such a way that it might be less easy to discern my anatomy. In fact, my work is inspired by infinite stimuli, the arrangement of branches in a tree, a piece of music, a scent, a sculpture, or a book of poetry might suggest new forms. I'm heavily influenced by contemporary dance, although I don't consider myself to be a dancer. In discovering new forms, I often move slowly until I arrive in an arrangement of shapes that I feel innately beautiful or intriguing. The ephemeral forms that I create are often direct emotional responses to the environments that I'm located within and the people that I share them with, or in fact, to my body itself. And I occasionally try to subvert the traditional norms of the kinds of poses that life models are expected to create, sometimes just for fun, but most of the time to demonstrate that those forms are not the only ones of artistic merit within the life room or studio environment. I hope that those slides have made some sense of the arguments that I'm advancing, and that my work might have been revealed unambiguously as a form of performance art, symbiotic performance art, in fact. Clearly, context is a critical factor. The work I just showed you would not often lend itself to the anatomy class that we discussed earlier. I'm aware that my role in part is to serve the students and tutors I work with, and I often enjoy fulfilling that role. That being said, my intent right from the start was to use my body to create works of art in symbiosis with other artists and to be understood unambiguously and respected as an artist in my own right. While undertaking research for this lecture, I interviewed Christopher Lebrun, the past president of the Royal Academy, where I've worked as a life model for several years and continue to. And when I asked Christopher whether it might be possible that life models are engaged in an artistic practice in their own right, he suggested that although it might be possible, there was a perceptual problem. Given that context was key, and that within the context of the life room, the filter by which the life model is interpreted and understood has been the Western academic tradition of drawing, it might be the case that no matter what motivation the model might have for creating their work, and no matter how artistically charged it might be, they might only ever be viewed as a mercenary drawing instrument functioning to serve the artists who assemble to draw them, paint them, or sculpt them, rather than coexisting in creative symbiosis. In fact, it's so often been the case that immediately after a life drawing class concludes, someone approaches me and asks, "So what do you do then? So is this, you know, what do you do outside of this? What do you do?" And my, you know, and in fact, they sometimes say, "Are you an out of work actor? Are you an out of work actor, Dominic?" And my heart sinks because I want to say to them, "Didn't you just see what I was doing? Did you not see what I was just doing? My artistry unfolded before your very eyes and then it vanished and you missed it. You were drawing, but not seeing." However, Christopher suggested that were I to locate my practice in a situation within which the people viewing me were not drawing me or learning to draw from me, rather actively engaging with my work in the same way they might a painting or a sculpture in a gallery, my artistry might be revealed. So then my work itself would remain unchanged, but the context would be different. And within that new perceptual framework, my artistry would crystallize in the minds of the viewers. I feel strongly that life modeling need not be an activity that takes place within the traditional contexts prescribed by Western academic artistic traditions. It might happen in any given context, whether the life room, studio, or beyond. And its symbiotic creative nature might be revealed, as Christopher Lebrun suggested, through the interaction of the viewer with the work. And in fact, neither viewer or practitioner would be passive. It would be an active engagement on both sides of this symbiotic relationship. You'd both be symbiotically engaged with each other. Indeed, this new way of thinking is one that Anne Noble Partridge, director of London Drawing, shares. And I've spoken with Anne many times about this over the last few years. And we in fact share a fairly close artistic relationship together. And it's Anne's belief that the life model could control or even dictate the nature of the unfolding drawing session, even to the extent that the life model dictates or directs the other artists assembled, not to draw them, but merely to experience their evolving work grounded in their body. So that the life model would be directing the dynamic. And in that way, I suppose that you could suggest that the hierarchical power structure, if there was one, would be subverted, be turned on its head. And I find that fascinating. So, you know, and very sympathetic with Christopher Lebrun, you know, the life model could locate themselves in different contexts and they need not be drawing situations. At around the same time that I talked with Christopher Lebrun, the work of Chinese artist Zhu Zhen came to my attention. He staged a performance installation at MoCA, the Museum of Contemporary Art in Los Angeles, in 2019, in just a blink of the eye, which you can see here. In just a blink of the eye. And MoCA director Klaus Biesenbach said of the work that it visualizes that performance art is both sculpture and life. It's a living sculpture in its multiplicity, in variations. Echoing Biesenbach's sentiments, Joe Bering, director of the Ingram Collection, feels in relation to the life model that the role doesn't have to be restricted to one compartment. It is many and varied, and within particular contexts may be considered to be an art form, a form of living sculpture, Zizhen's work made a tremendous impact on me at the time I first viewed it, and inspired a new body of work that I created first within the life room at the Royal Academy, but then outside of it in videographic form while undertaking a 2021 art residency at the Crypt Gallery, London. The following videographic installation, which I titled Intersect, was one of the installations that happened at the Crypt. It's 1 minute long and I'd like to share it with you now. I'll see you on the other side. Please don't go away. This is a 1 minute video installation and I have a few other points I'd like to discuss with you after this installation concludes, and I'll see you on the other side. Welcome back, and I hope that you enjoyed Intersect. This leads us to the final issues I would like to discuss, which are directly related to one another. Firstly, the attitudes of art schools towards the life models that they employ, and the impact of those attitudes on wider cultural perceptions. And secondly, the seismic impact of the pandemic on the life drawing universe. And as I mentioned, these are intimately related facets of the emerging debate. And they resonate on a deeply personal level to me, in fact, because these competing factors directly inspired me to write this lecture in 2016. In relation to the first issue, I believe it's important to reflect upon the historic role of the life model within the academy system as a mercenary drawing instrument, because I think that contemporary attitudes have been fundamentally shaped by that position. According to this idea, life models might, as I mentioned earlier, be considered to be servants undertaking menial tasks rather than skilled practitioners engaged in a physically and emotionally demanding role that might even become an artistic practice in its own right, according to the determining factors of context and motivation that I've outlined and that I've proposed. I believe that the attitudes of art schools towards life models may be revealed through the very low rates of pay that most art schools award models and the conditions that they provide for models to work within. When examining these factors, it is difficult not to conclude as a generalized statement that art schools view life models as expendable commodities. There are obvious exceptions, of course. The Royal Academy, for instance, cares very deeply about the life models it employs, and it values their contribution as creative partners within the classes and workshops that they deliver. And of course, it goes without saying also that that RCA Drawing also does. And I love working with RCA Drawing. When I began life modelling, the rates of pay that art schools awarded were risible. I mentioned earlier that I worked full time as a life model for a period of years. And by full time, I meant that I often worked 18-hour days from when I left home in the morning to arriving home in the evening, and 6 to 7 day weeks, and often 20 days in a row. And I did that in order to survive, as did many colleagues. The typical rates that I was offered by art schools ranged from £8 per hour to £15 per hour, with a few institutions offering £15 an hour or above, and fewer still offering above £20 an hour. These rates unambiguously maintain the life model in precarious financial positions. When you factor in travel time and costs, in fact, life modelling almost approaches becoming untenable professionally in the long term as a physical practice. Models have therefore been undervalued financially and by extension, existentially, by the very institutions that often owe their existence to them. Rates of pay, I believe, always begin as ideological, not financial concerns. Committees within art schools, often comprised of artists occupying roles in senior management teams, take active decisions to reward models among the lowest rates of pay in those schools, deeming the work models undertake only to be worthy of such rates. I've always believed this to be morally questionable. When offered a class that is 2 hours long, at a rate of £14 per hour, for instance, after investing an hour travelling each way, and you of course absorb the travel costs, buying some food and arriving 15 minutes early, as any professional life model would, it would be very unlikely that a life model would earn more than £18 for this 4.5 hour block of time. It's probably going to be less in real terms for undertaking what would inevitably be physically demanding work. And in fact, in real terms, that works out to be less than the minimum wage, I think. In fact, I know it's absolutely less than the minimum wage in real terms. And similarly, in cases within which models are afforded the chance to work within full days, they would invariably be paid less than £15 per hour and obliged to accept work in the evening in order simply to break even. This is an issue that I've campaigned vocally about since the second half of 2016, with some minor successes. Between 2016 and 2018, I met the directors of almost every art school in London to query the reasons why they approved rates of pay that neither reflected the work models undertook or were in some cases even possible to live on. I was routinely advised that art schools were small charitable organisations with limited budgets and significant rental or heating costs, or with dwindling class sizes. It was difficult, and in fact, I was also told many times that, well, we pay you slightly above the living wage or slightly above the minimum wage, which I found very difficult to comprehend because I never understood how it could be that the living wage or the minimum wage even would be the measures by which a life model's pay rate would be calculated. And I certainly don't think it's a noble gesture to offer these kinds of rates of pay. And in fact, I would go further and suggest that it was difficult not to conclude that those art schools expected models to subsidise their charitable statuses through the very low rates of pay that they rewarded. Self-employed models were, of course, unable to negotiate their pay rates, and they were often fearful that speaking out would result in their being blacklisted. At the time when I was modelling full-time, I knew life models who were taking active decisions, and these were models working full-time. They were taking active decisions about whether to pay their rent or to eat food at the end of the month. And I couldn't reconcile this in my mind. It didn't make moral sense to me. It didn't make existential sense. And in fact, this was ultimately the catalyst for my deciding to abandon professional life modelling as a full-time way of being in order to pursue a literary career, because I couldn't survive. So there was the practical concern, but I couldn't also tacitly endorse what I perceived to be exploitative work practices through my participation in them. But the pandemic brought about a seismic shift in attitudes and working conditions, redressing the balance of power and fostering a new climate within which models were, to a greater extent than ever before, regarded as artists in their own right. At the start of the pandemic, life models were, unlike many other colleagues within the arts institutions they worked, unable to benefit from furlough payments, for instance, and were therefore obliged to find other methods of continuing modelling and generating an income because, of course, all of the classes stopped. Online groups emerged relatively quickly, and life models could, as individual practitioners, assume control over their own destiny by setting up and curating their own events, as I did on a couple of occasions, as well as collaborating with RCA drawing within an online class that they created. This changing landscape has been the catalyst for a new way of valuing the life model within art history and within art practice. Models, asserting themselves unambiguously as artists, could, through the online sessions they established, channel their creativity while simultaneously commanding rates of pay that it was not merely possible to live on, but which reflected the work that they undertook and which they could thrive on. As this new landscape unfolded during the first half of the pandemic, I remember calling my colleague Aurélie Debaene, who I'm co-curating the symposium at the University of Kent I mentioned earlier. I remember phoning and excitedly explaining the new reality that life models now inhabited, detailing these new rates of pay, the new rates of pay that we were able to command, because it was actually very possible for life models to earn between 50 and 100 pounds an hour. And actually, I know life models who earned more than this. I know life models who earn 150 pounds an hour, or perhaps 200 pounds for a single hour's work. And I remember asking Aurélie, well, how given that life models are assuming control financially now, and that they're now respected artistically through these events that they curate in the online sphere, how could they ever consider returning to art schools within which they were not properly valued, respected? And by extension, how could any art school expect life models to return to them with open arms or goodwill, the goodwill that they had been showing historically? And I believe, in fact, that the changing landscape goes a long way towards answering those questions. Models in positions to refuse the arbitrarily low rates of pay that art schools offered started rejecting work when the art schools began delivering life drawing classes and painting and sculpture classes as lockdown restrictions eased. Many London art schools are now in the process of improving their pay rates. In fact, between the summer of 2021 and February 2022, almost every art school in London improved their rate of pay. And I don't think that that's a coincidence, given that wages have historically stagnated. Rates of pay have dramatically removed also in the peripheral landscape, so that it's now common for independent life drawing groups to pay models in excess of £25 an hour. And in fact, several groups that I'm now aware of are paying £50 an hour to life models, where those rates might previously have ranged from £14 to £20 an hour in the months leading up to the pandemic. And so the landscape is changing. Life models are directing their own destiny, and they are inhabiting new territory within which their practice is properly respected. Well, we're now approaching the conclusion of my lecture, and I'd like to thank you for travelling on this journey with me. I hope I might have persuaded you that life modelling has the potential to be an artistic practice, given particular motivations on the part of the practitioner and the contexts within which they locate themselves. And I'd like to leave you with a quote that Joe Baring, the director of the Ingram Collection, made about my theoretical hypothesis about motivation and context, but also my physical practice, which I believe validates my position. And I'm looking forward to meeting you all in a moment for the Q&A, which Sarah will be moderating. Thank you so much.
Wow.
Thank you so much, Dominic.
Round of applause for Dominic.
Fantastic.
So good. Wow. Better than RCA lectures, I would say, in terms of like intensity and rate of content. And yeah, wonderful. Thank you, Dom, for this incredible, incredible lecture.
Thanks.
So we are going to start with the Q&A, and Sarah is
Did you mind if I say something very, very quickly?
Yes, go on.
Just like super quickly. You might not all be aware of this, but there are three actually. There are definitely two people who I want to draw attention to. One of them is Tiziana and the other one is Cam David. And in relation to what I was just saying, and also Naomi, wow, you too, you also should be included in this, but you're probably aware of Tiziana and David and Naomi. They're all amazing life models, but more important than that, well, no, equally as important, Tiziana and David have been involved. They've been campaigning. This is the main point. They've been campaigning so hard to improve conditions over the last year, more than a year, and putting themselves out there at potentially great cost to work that they might be offered. I've explained this very, I have tremendous respect for you. That's all I can tell you. I'm very happy that you're here and you're inspirational to me. And I'm just so happy that we get to work together actually, because the work that you've done is tremendous. And I think that through the work you've done. You've changed attitudes yourselves, and you've also unquestionably been the catalyst for change. I think the reason why pay rates have increased has in part been due to your efforts. So I'm so happy you're here. I've got great respect for you. So thank you so much. Something I wanted to say, but now I'll be quiet.
No, don't be quiet. I noticed in the chat there were some questions starting to emerge. Carrie-Anne, would you like to ask your question to Dominic personally?
Yeah, that's fine. Brilliant. Hello. That was really interesting. Thank you. I made notes. It's lovely. Wow. So my question was, I wrote a lot of the sentences down, but one of the striking sentences was the idea that you move from, you know, if I've got this wrong, please correct me, you move from figurative to abstract. I think people think about abstract art differently, but to me, the idea of abstract art is this sense of you can abstract what you want from it. So it gives a great freedom to artistic interpretation. And I just wanted your explanation as to, is that what you're trying to do? So you're trying to say, because this is what you normally see as a life model. I'm a figure, I'm a pose, I'm a person, I'm a human body, but watch me move into these different spaces and different places. And what do you see now? Is that the kind of thing? Or what are your thoughts around that?
Yeah, in part, I think that's an accurate observation. I'm really, really pleased that you've made it. And thanks for the question. I suppose part of it might be a negative reaction to the kinds of forms, or I hate the term pose, but, and I can explain that, but the kinds of forms that you're expected to inhabit, perhaps within the anatomy class, the contrapposto pose, you know, for instance, the saccharine reclining pose that you might have to inhabit. It might be that I'm reacting, I have a complex about these sorts of poses, and I'm reacting negatively against them. I think that the human form is amazing, and it's intriguing to me. And I find this is why I'm not necessarily the best model to work with in an anatomy class, even though I'm quite accomplished at that, I suppose, like my colleagues here also are. I suppose it's because I feel that I can end up being quite self-indulgent. I don't want to stand in a contrapposto pose. I want to use my body as my medium of expression to create works of art. It might be that, sounds really contrived. It's never really contrived. I'm just responding to the environments that I've located myself in. And if the poses or the forms I create end up moving into abstraction so that my anatomy is not easily discernible, it's probably not the result of a complex. But it's just that I'm using my body as my medium of expression, like an abstract painter might, like a Jackson Pollock might, to just create art. I'm channeling my emotions into this thing, using my body as my paintbrush, I suppose. But there is a bit of that. I feel like it's depressing that the Western academic traditions have grown up. Oh, wow, I think it's depressing that they dictate the way that the model should behave. I find that really just boring.
Can I be really cheeky and ask one more question?
No, I'd like it if you did, yeah.
From what you've just said then, is there a pressure, and again, if I've got this wrong, please tell me, but it sounds like you're balancing site-specific performance, processes of improvisation, while meeting the objective of the employers. Is that right? And is that a pressure?
This is the ultimate. Okay, you've arrived at the ultimate point for me as an individual, and it's that at some stage. So you know, my motivation. You know, I told you that motivation and context were the critical factors that might determine if a life model becomes an artist. And from my perspective, I started life modeling with one very specific motivation in mind, and that was to engage in an artistic practice, to use my body as my medium of expression. Even though I acknowledge that the typical contexts within which life models might locate their practice are, you know, the life from environment, the anatomy class, within which these really dull poses are prescribed, the, you know, this contrapposto pose which you inhabit for 45 minutes, really boring to me. I know that's one part of the role, but that was never my intention. And so I suppose in direct response to your question, the ultimate aim I had when I started, well, I felt like it was a form of performance art, and my idealistic notion was that I would exist, this is when it's at most electric, when you exist not within a hierarchical power structure as I described, so this is the art up here, this is the model down here, you're on a plateau within creative symbiosis with an other artist. Here's the artist, here's an artist, and here's another artist. This artist might be called a model, this artist might be called a painter. And so what I've always hoped to do is move far away from the anatomy class, because I do not want to engage in what I call anatomical data entry. Now, that's a role that life models may fulfill. It's just not a role that I've ever been interested in. And so, yes, I've worked within anatomy classes, but that's a critical thing. When I work within an anatomy class, it's not that I don't enjoy listening to the tutor especially, but that is work. I go there, it's anatomical data entry, I stand there and I get paid to do it. But it's a very specific sort of dynamic. But when I get the opportunity to improvise the forms that I create, then it becomes an artistic practice. When I started life modeling, I probably did have an idealistic notion of what it might be all about, what it might be like. And I thought everyone would see it the same way that I did. But then I discovered that people don't, because the filter is the Western academic tradition of fine art, painting, sculpture, the mercenary drawing instrument. This is the filter by which life modeling is understood. So I guess I became disillusioned quickly on, quite early on, and then that compounded with the risible rates of pay, which I believed meant that, you know, it's very apparent early on that art schools viewed life models as expendable commodities. So you had all these compounding factors, the existential perception, which was channeled through the Western academic tradition of fine art, within which you're a mercenary drawing instrument. I reacted against that. And then the attitudes on the part of the art schools. And all I really wanted was for people to see me as potentially, not always, but potentially an autonomous creative being with agency in my own right. And the thing is, I was very conscious just then, I talked a lot about myself, but any number of, like, I can see Naomi here is in the she's participating in this Q&A, she's here, and she's an amazing artist in her own right. If you see her work, it's far out, and so is David's and Tiziana. I mean, that's the point. So I suppose I've clumsily explained that, but if anything, life models fulfill a myriad of roles. One role that they fulfill is the anatomy model. This is why I wanted to suggest that you have these spectrums of creativity. I want to distance myself from the muse. I don't assume a passive role, or if I do, that's in a narrow compartment. I'm an artist using my body to create art, and I like to exist within artistic relationships, probably more so than creating this art on my own. It's a form of performance art, and I like to work with other people. And I don't know if that's helped to explain. I'm worried I'm waffling, so I'll stop talking.
Lucy's got a question for you now, Dom.
Oh, hey, Lucy.
Hey, Dom. I was just going to say, in relation to that question and your response from Carrie-Anne, sorry, is that how you say your name? The movement from figurative to abstract through inhabiting a shape, creating a shape in the room at that moment. For me, like, the fact that it is ephemeral, it's suddenly lost, we don't see it again, is kind of integral to what you're doing. Do you feel, therefore, that documentation, having a video, is essential for your practice? Because we wouldn't, in comparison to, say, the student's production at the end of the class, where there's a bunch of amazing drawings of that transition, perhaps from a figurative to an abstract state, your work relies on documentation in order to be seen? Or do you feel there's something more elusive going on?
Well, that's such an interesting question. I suppose there are two ways that I would answer it. The first of which is that you probably are aware that I've delved into videographic performance art, and I create that work entirely on my own. And no one is around to view it when I'm creating it. It's clearly not a drawing situation of any kind. And however, I record it. I mean, I sort of locate myself in interesting places, like the last one. Well, one of the last ones was a crypt, which I lived in for a little time. But then no one's allowed to view it until it's finished. And then it's created in this, you know, I create these videographic representations. I've struggled with this because sometimes I feel like maybe the most important thing isn't that it's drawn at all. Maybe it's that it's experienced, and then because it is ephemeral, the work can only exist as long as I can maintain the form. Because, you know, you can't maintain it for, you know, indefinitely. But what might be interesting is if it exists as fragments of memories in people's minds.
I mean, ultimately ends up in the drawing wonderfully on the page. But at the same time, I feel like your method is kind of, as you say, relies on the private record or your choice of record as well. You know,
but there is something there's something that's occurred to me as well, which is that do you remember when we were at the V&A, Lucy, and if you walked through a gallery, you'd find any number of people with a camera snapping away, and they'd arrive in a gallery and snap, 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 and this was the filter by which they interpreted the art that they're looking at in a passive way. And that to me is depressing too. Maybe the most important thing is just to experience it. Maybe that could be the most important thing. And actually what I'm, so I find myself sometimes really reacting negatively against the drawing situation. And what I really want sometimes is simply to perform in front of a group of people who are not drawing, who are not allowed to photograph what I'm doing, and they just experience it. But of course, then the most important thing I have come to realise through creating videographic performance art on my own is that I do require other people to be present when I create my work. It's a constant battle, though. The only way I can really respond is, you know, Christopher Lebrun, I mentioned, he talked about how changing contexts will create changed perceptual frameworks. And it's those perceptual frameworks that allow the artistry to be understood. So, you know, the practice might be identical, but you place yourself in a gallery and then your artistry is understood in a way it wasn't before because you're not a mercenary drawing instrument. I don't know. I suppose ultimately I'm happy to just locate myself in a place and do whatever it is that I'm doing, respond to the environment that I've located myself in, and then whatever else happens around me can happen.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. Thanks for that answer, Dom.
Sorry, I waffled along.
No, you didn't.
Do we have any other questions from the audience at all? Please just unmute yourself if you'd like to ask a question.
I haven't got a question, but I just wanted to say, Dominic, that when I was drawing you in the session before, what I found was I couldn't use language, and that was so helpful.
Oh, wow.
Because I couldn't say to myself, that's an arm, that's a head, that's a leg. And the preconceptions that go with labelling stuff, for me, is very unhelpful when I'm trying to draw something. I don't know if that's true for other people as well, but it stops me looking, actually. So I just wanted to say that.
I'm very happy about that. I suppose because I don't want to be a mercenary drawing instrument. I've always battled against this. And therefore you're unable to view me in that way. The only way that you can view me is as an abstract form. And then the emotional intent behind what I'm doing might be more apparent, or maybe it isn't, maybe it's so abstract that you wouldn't have a clue what it is that I'm thinking, but you're not viewing me in terms of measurements in that sense. You're not viewing me as this series of lines. Yeah, I mean, it's very far out of the realm of the art class. It's far beyond that. Yeah, it's an interesting thing actually, because initially I left modelling within art classes because of these issues, what I perceive to be exploitation. But then actually it's also it's moved beyond that. And I sometimes feel uncomfortable I'll be honest with you, 90% of art classes I feel uncomfortable working within, because it just doesn't make sense in my mind what's actually unfolding. It does. I'm not antagonistic towards it, but just as an individual, it's not what I want to be doing. But then I do still life model. And the reason I still life model is because there are those situations that you find yourself in with like people who you might work with, where it's so just, I was about to swear. I won't swear in the lecture, but it's just electric, you could say. It's just so amazing. You really travel on these symbiotic journeys. I don't know. I don't know if that answers your question. Oh, it wasn't really. Yeah, it was an amazing observation. I'm very grateful to you.
Thank you.
Would anyone else like to ask anything? Or is there anything you'd like to say, Dominic, to kind of sum up at all?
Well, actually, the funny thing is I want to know what David has to say.
So say that, so it was marvellous, marvellous talk. And, you know, you speak so eloquently. And, when I first came into life modelling, you know, you were one of the first models I sort of saw, and your work and what you were doing, you know, sort of 4 or 5 years ago when I first, you know, came across, was, you know, hugely inspiring. And you immediately were showing me, as someone new to life modeling, what life modeling could be, and yes, far beyond the kind of academic and the conventional. I think reframing what the life model is today, you know, as performance, and reframing that for everyone involved, the life models, the artists, the students, tutors, the institutions at large, if we reframe it in the way that you've spoken about today, I think we could all get so much more out of it. And I think yes, we're missing so much, and I think people don't really realize. And I think when you say that we are drawing in space, and also that also when institutions frame the life model as a kind of object that's just put in the middle of the room, mm-hmm. and the students and artists go in thinking, I just want to learn how to draw a person, they're just already denying themselves so much potential in themselves.
Yes, I agree.
I think often people end up, they're looking and they're maybe drawing, but they're not seeing.
Exactly.
And that's such a powerful phrase that I've written down several times. reframing that in this new kind of, you know, as we come out of the pandemic, and I think people are beginning to look again at what the life model is all about. I think it's a very exciting time. I think there are some institutions that are holding on to this conventional idea of a life model, and I'm hoping that the audience at large, you know, the people who are, you know, going into courses, that they'll actually will be demanding more and saying, actually, I don't want just a body to draw. I want to collaborate more with the model. I think we're seeing more of that. The institutions aren't leading that. It's the art groups, the other groups, and RCA as well. I mean, whenever the first time I modeled for you guys too, immediately you were saying to me, okay, you know, this is the space here. You know, we want you to respond to it. You know, we're going to be maybe doing you know, these kind of things, but you have agency, and it's one of the few places where life modeling is framed in that way, and it's always so much more satisfying and rewarding. And I think the work from the students is stronger. That's mm-hmm. the thing. You know, everyone benefits when you have this more of a collaboration, you know, collaborative approach. The work that comes out of it is always stronger. It's yes. There's life to it. And you can learn all the technical stuff that you need to at the same time. So that's what I've always wanted to kind of promote as well. But yes, I've been working with Titiana and Louise Herford and others, you know, to promote better paying conditions for life models. So I'm hugely grateful to be able to kind of, you know, be part of that. And, you know, just to recap, you know, in the start of the pandemic, there was a Zoom call where we had about 20 different life models kind of just all chiming in. And then this sort of campaign that's kind of taking, you know, small steps, but every day we're kind of doing a bit more to really underscore what life modeling is today. And we deserve more pay, but it's not just about pay. It's also about reframing, you know, how we approach it. And
I'm so grateful to you for your comments. And I just wanted to say, because the thing is, it's not about pay in an arbitrary way. It's what it represents. And to my mind, it represents something existential, and it's the value that art schools place on models. Like I say, that we're exchangeable commodities, there you go. And I find that depressing. Naturally, it has it's a practical concern, because if you can't afford to eat food, that's not good. But I mean, it's far wider than that. These attitudes are grotesque to me. Wow. I mean, thanks so much for everything you just said, David.
No, thank you. Thank you as well. I do feel that there are some places that I think, I don't know if it's true, but I guess I think they kind of burn through new models. And these new models sort of before they...
Dominic.
Oh. Go on, Tiana.
Hello.
Yeah, sorry. I'm on a tube, so I wanted just to say just quickly thank you to everybody, and so mostly.
Hi, Tatiana.
To Dominic, because the whole movement that we are doing with David, for me personally, started from your lecture at the Mall Gallery. Was brilliant, oh, wow. And then was highlighting all the aspects and all the, you know, the hard history and all the struggle that we face.
Thanks, Tiziano. I don't know if you can hear me. I think you may have moved into a tunnel or something, but that means a lot to me.
So it all started from you. So can you hear me?
Oh, yes, I can hear you. That meant so much. But it's a collective effort, that's for sure. But that really, I mean, we're all in this together. And yeah, that meant a lot to me. And yes, these are new times. The landscape is changing, and it's amazing.
Yeah, I think so. And I really hope that life models, you know, we connect more with each other and talk to each other more. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm always trying to foster those connections and reaching out to models. And I know that models do. We all do a myriad of different things to make up a whole. You know, I think that's the beauty, you know, of it. You know, we bring so much of ourselves and different things that we're doing, you know, into it. And everyone's different. I hope that that life models, you know, are getting more and more empowered.
Hello.
Make the right decisions for themselves, to say no to those places that, you know, don't value them.
Yes, I quite agree. Thanks so much for sharing.
I was just gonna say, in relation to that point, sorry to interrupt, but what David was saying there about, you know, encouraging experimentation, innovation, kind of fluidity in practice, I think is really, really necessary. That although we're, like, you know, living in the 21st century, we've still got, I've noticed within studios, like, quite a limit, you know, there are limitations onto how much students do maybe can't go outside the box, outside the comfort zone of what they're doing. Obviously, within life drawing, though, there are parameters, aren't there? Perhaps you both have got an opinion on that in terms of your role within the... It is a public space. You know, there are legalities around what life models can do. I mean, Dominic, we talked about doing work in landscape, didn't we? But you told me that we couldn't, you know, we can't just go to the park, or you can't just go to the beach and model. There are parameters there. So do you think, is it therefore something to do with navigation? Do you navigate context of working, or do you adapt? I mean, yeah.
Well, you have to adapt. I mean, you have to be conscious of the potential audiences who might be viewing your work. I mean, that's for sure. You have to consider the impact that your work might have on other people. I think that's for sure. But I mean, actually, this is not necessarily the most appropriate time, because I know that we're going to conclude in a moment, but that moves into different territory, actually, because then you can consider issues of taboos and why the attitudes people have to the human form, and that's a whole interesting other discussion I think that might be worth engaging in. Issues of censorship are really interesting to me. What is it that offends people about the human form? But context is obviously very important. It's obviously really critical. I suppose people have to, I guess people have to know what they're about to enter into. That's pretty important. You don't want to surprise or shock someone and upset them. But I don't know. I'd have to think
talk about that another time. Talk about that in another lecture series, maybe. Does anybody else have any questions before we start like wrapping up?
I think that brings us to the end of our session then. I just want to ask everyone to congratulate Dominic on a fantastic talk and say thank you to him one more time. Many people have expressed thanks in the comments. I hope you've seen them. And I want to say thank you to everyone who's come to join us today as well. It's been a really lovely group. Sorry, I've just realised Dom is still spotlighted. thank you, Dominic. We will be in touch on social media about when we do our next public event. And for our CAE people, we'll be in touch on our intranet. But for now, I hope you all have a wonderful evening. And thank you again for joining us.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you,
Michael.
Thank you, Bye. Dominic. Nice to see you.
See you soon. Take care. Bye-bye.
Ciao.